oxygen is not the only molecule that can bind onto the heme group of hemoglobin. Another molecule that can bind to the same exact group in hemoglobin is carbon monoxide. And in fact, carbon monoxide is about 250 times as likely to actually bind to hemoglobin than oxygen. And what that means is when we have oxygen, carbon monoxide, and hemoglobin present in the same mixture, carbon monoxide will have no problem outcompeting the oxygen for that heme group on hemoglobin. On top of that, when carbon monoxide actually binds onto hemoglobin, because of its very high affinity, it's very difficult to actually displace and release the carbon monoxide from hemoglobin. Now, the question is, how exactly does the binding of carbon monoxide onto hemoglobin affect the oxygen-hemoglobin dissociation curve? So, to see what the effect is, let's take a look at the following diagram. So, as always, the y-axis is the percentage saturation of hemoglobin inside our blood plasma, and it ranges from 0 to 100%. Now, the x-axis is the partial pressure of oxygen inside our tissues given to us in millimeters of mercury. So, it ranges from 0 to 100. Now, the blue curve describes the normal oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve. That is, it describes a situation when we have no carbon monoxide present inside our blood plasma. On the other hand, the red curve describes a situation when we do have carbon monoxide present inside the blood plasma. In fact, it describes a particular situation where 50% of the hemoglobin is occupied by carbon monoxide. And whenever carbon monoxide binds onto hemoglobin, we call the hemoglobin carboxyhemoglobin. Now, the question is, what exactly can we tell from this curve? Well, first thing we can see is, if we examine this side of the curve, the red curve is found to the left of the normal blue curve. And what that means is, by binding to our hemoglobin, what carbon monoxide does is it creates a leftward shift in our curve. The question is, why does this actually take place, and what physiological consequence does this actually have on the tissues of our body? Well, basically, when carbon monoxide binds onto the heme group of hemoglobin, it makes the other empty heme groups much more likely to actually bind oxygen molecules. So by binding to our hemoglobin, carbon monoxide makes or increases the affinity of hemoglobin to oxygen. And that's exactly what creates this leftward shift in the first place. So due to the higher affinity of carboxyhemoglobin to oxygen, it will make it much less likely that the hemoglobin will actually release the oxygen to the tissues and cells that are exercising in our body. Therefore, even though we'll have plenty of oxygen present in the atmosphere and inside our blood plasma, because carboxyhemoglobin binds oxygen so much more strongly than in the normal case, much less of the oxygen will actually arrive at the tissues of our body. And this condition that can ultimately lead to suffocation is known as carbon monoxide poisoning. Now, the other effect that the binding of carbon monoxide has on hemoglobin curve is the following. Notice that the blue curve is found much higher than the red curve. We see that there is a drop in our curve. The question is why? Why does this take place, and what effect does it have on our tissues? Well, basically, once carbon monoxide actually binds onto one of the heme groups of hemoglobin, it decreases the amount of oxygen that the hemoglobin can actually bind. For example, if a given hemoglobin molecule is bound to two carbon monoxides, that means only two oxygen can actually bind onto the hemoglobin versus the four oxygen in the normal case. So what this does is it decreases the oxygen carrying capacity of the hemoglobin inside our blood plasma. And that's why we have the drop in this curve. And that means because we have a decrease in oxygen carrying capacity, once again, less oxygen will be ultimately delivered to the tissues of our body. So two effects are in place. We have a drop in the curve, which is a result of the actual binding of the CO to our hemoglobin. It decreases the oxygen carrying capacity. And effect number two is we have a leftward shift in the curve. And this means that carboxy hemoglobin decreases the affinity of increases the affinity of hemoglobin to oxygen, and that means oxygen will be held much more tightly by the hemoglobin and less of it will be released and unloaded to the tissues of our body. So we conclude that although our body actually does produce a very tiny amount of carbon monoxide, and carbon monoxide does have a certain beneficial effect in our body, because our body naturally produces such a small quantity of hemoglobin, our blood contains about 0 millimeters of mercury of carbon monoxide, that means our carbon monoxide or natural levels of carbon monoxide inside our blood plasma have no adverse effects on hemoglobin. However, other processes that take place outside of our body, for example, the production of car exhaust or the process of smoking, these processes produce much more carbon monoxide. And if we are exposed to even a small amount of carbon monoxide that comes from these processes, it can ultimately lead to the condition of carbon monoxide poisoning. Now, how exactly would one treat carbon monoxide poisoning? Well, recall that carbon monoxide and oxygen bind to the same exact location on hemoglobin, and they bind reversibly. And what that means is carbon monoxide is actually a competitive inhibitor of oxygen. So recall that in competitive inhibition, by increasing the concentration of the substrate, in this case the oxygen, we can actually cause the oxygen to outcompete the carbon monoxide for that position on the heme group of hemoglobin. And so by increasing the amount of oxygen inside our blood, we can actually treat the carbon monoxide poisoning. In fact, that's exactly how it is treated by doctors.